The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's bringing you the news with interviews and views from behind the news, providing you the information that you need to know.
It's a groovy.
It sure is with Nicole Sandler. The Nicole Sandler Show.com and Progressive Voices Network present Nicole Sandler.
When you're working or driving through the day, live it up all the way with the 91.
The 91? Lively radio. All right. I don't know where that came from, except Boca Brittany Summers, who just threw that in my inbox. So there you go. Lively radio. Hey, we're lively today. Oh, well, God, welcome to it. It's a Thursday and things are getting weirder. They go from strange to weird to really sick and creepy. In fact, I wonder if I have it up here. Let me see if it's in my wall o' sound or not. I had a sounder, a little a drop, as it were, of Shepard Smith back from some old and now I can't find it, of course, now I don't have it here, so I don't even know why I brought it up, but there's a clip of him saying politics is weird and creepy, and it had to do with Newt Gingrich, of all people. Yeah, I seem to have lost it. I'll get it for you maybe by tomorrow, if I remember. Anyway, it doesn't, but politics are weird and creepy. And Donald Trump is the creepiest of them all. What's going on is just insane. So I've got a lot of news to get to today. And of course, today is, what is today? it is Thursday. So Howie Klein will be along. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff to take care of. But you know, I like to start the show with something funny. And again, I have this sort of love-hate relationship with a group called The Parody Project. This guy, Don Karen, has been making these song parodies for a long time. He's one of the people who was doing it before it became the quarantine thing to do, make a fun, parody video while we're all stuck at home. He's been doing these for a while, and they seem to have gotten a little darker with time, where they used to be, you know, like, ha-ha, funny. Now they're sort of, funny. And that's where, that's the category that this one falls under, I believe. So, it fits for today. It's so perfect, because you got idiot Trump out there openly admitting to sabotaging the U.S. Postal Service because he doesn't want you to be able to vote by mail. Because he knows that the more people can vote, the worse it is for him. It goes back to that clip that I've played for you over and over and over throughout the years from 1980 and Paul Weyrich, who was one of the founders of ALEC and the Heritage Foundation, I believe, who said, we don't want everyone to vote. When more people vote, Republicans lose.
Now, many of our Christians have what I call the goo-goo syndrome. Good government.
You know this
they
by heart now,
right? They want everybody to vote. I don't want everybody to vote. Elections are not won by a majority of people. They never have been from the beginning of our country, and they are not now. As a matter of fact, our leverage in the elections, quite candidly, goes up as the voting populace goes down.
Again, they play the long game, and they know that... They play the long game, and so... they've been working on this. That clip was recorded in 1980. Oh, I see. So David found the clip for me. So here it is.
Here. Mitt Romney has released a statement on the departure of Newt Gingrich from the campaign.
It was about Newt Gingrich.
He reads in part, Ann and I are proud to call Newt and Callista friends. We look forward to working with them in the months and years ahead.
Yep. Here.
That from Mitt Romney.
Politics
is weird
and creepy.
And now I know lacks even the loosest attachment
to reality.
To anything like reality.
There you go. Shepard Smith, one of my favorite quotes. I had cut out the beginning part. I usually have it handy for me, but I don't know what I did with it. But my husband to the rescue. That's, husbands are good for things like that, you know. Shepard Smith, I frankly can't wait for his show to premiere on CNBC. It's going to be on weeknights, 7 p.m. And allegedly, it's going to be an actual news show. Like, not taking sides, not offering editorial commentary, just presenting the facts. Who would have thought? What a concept. Because, I don't watch Joy Reid at 7. And CNN with Erin Burnett is not a whole lot better, to be honest. So I'm looking forward to an actual real nightly newscast at 7 p.m. Eastern on CNBC hosted by Shepard Smith. Because I always thought he was fair when he was on Fox. Not that I watched him that often, but, you know, you get the idea. Anyway, I digress. I started telling you about the Parody Project and their latest song parody, which is quite fitting for a day like today, with the gaslighter in chief lying and making shit up. So let's wait no longer and turn it over to the Parody Project. Here we go.
1, 2, 3. Hail to the billionaire concealing income taxes. Hail to the genius whom aside his college grades. Hail to the smart guy who poetic never waxes. Hail to the businessman in bankruptcy charades. Hail to the Christian who was never known to pray, and all the Bible verses he was unable to say. Hail to the way he always claims to save the day. Hail to his toughness, his makeup, and his hairspray. Hail to the coward who hides inside a bunker, fencing off the White House to protect himself from what? Hail to Mar-a-Lago, where he likes to go and hunker. Hail to the cheater who's afraid to make a putt. Hail to the patriot with spurs upon his heel. Hail to the dealmaker who cannot close the deal. He claims that he is innocent but will not testify. His biggest lie of all was when he said he wouldn't lie.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3.
Hail to the playboy who claims it was all freebie. Hail to the family man caught cheating on his wife. Hail to the philanthropist who cheats his charity. Lying, cheating, hypocrite, the story of his life. Hail the millionaire who lost a billion in 10 years. Hail to the successful man whose wealth is in arrears. Hail to all the demons that are driving all his fears. Hail to what will be there when the darkness finally clears.
1, 2, 3.
Failed as the chief who was chosen for the nation. He failed as the chief, he has failed as one and all. He failed as the chief and he's causing us vexation. Instead of fulfillment of a great and noble call. He said he was gonna make the country even grander. No such thing has happened and he's caused us only grief. He failed us as the one that we selected as commander. He failed as the president. He failed as the chief. He failed as the chief. He failed as the chief. He failed as the chief.
The Parody Project, his name is Don Karen, parodyproject.com. He's been making these videos for a long time. He does all the parts, talented guy. I've reached out to him to invite him on the show, but never heard back. Anyway, it's, as I said, quite fitting for the day. All right, we got some news to get to, shall we? Let's do it to it.
Oh. I read the news today. Oh, boy.
Oh, boy. So there was quite a bit of breaking news today. First, and I don't quite know where to go with this, Donald Trump announced a deal between Israel and the United Arab Emirates to, quote, normalize relations. Problem is, I saw something shortly after his big announcement from the Times of Israel website. It keeps refreshing, so it moved past it. But it was a statement from the Crown Prince of the United Arab Emirates saying, well, yeah, not really. And hold on, let me see if I can't find the exact. Here it is. UAE Crown Prince Mohammed bin Zayed confirms in a tweet that Israel has agreed to suspend annexation plans, but says that the countries have only agreed to work toward the normalization of relations. The way Trump presented it is they've normalized relations between the United Arab Emirates and Israel. Yeah, not really. It says the UAE and Israel also agreed to cooperation in setting up a roadmap towards establishing a bilateral relationship. And that's, I guess, a good thing, but it's not what they said. Oh, and then by the way, Israel is saying, well, we're still going to do the settlements. They're just going to be delayed a little while. So am I missing something here? Doesn't seem like much happened. But that's what this administration does. That's what Donald Trump does. He lies. He gaslights. He makes shit up. So, for instance, this morning, because he's not on Fox enough, Trump did a phoner with Maria Boobs Bartiromo. I call her that because if you remember, I think it was still during the campaign, maybe. It was the, was it the gridiron dinner? One of those Catholic things, the Al Smith dinner or something, where the two candidates get up and they do something that's supposed to be funny. It's a church thing. Everyone's in black tie. And there's Trump speaking. And Maria Bartiromo was behind him with the most cleavage showing I've ever seen on a C-SPAN feed. And I kept thinking there was going to be some nip slip because it was so down there. So she is forever to me, Maria Boobs Bartiromo. But I digress. Anyway, this morning, he calls into her show, and in it, while he's being interviewed by her, if you can call that an interview, he stated unequivocally that he is deliberately not funding the U.S. Postal Service to stop you and us from having access to universal voting by mail for November's election, right? This is also Trump making explicit that he doesn't want to add funding for the Postal Service in any attempt. He wants to kneecap voting. Here's that that segment.
$3.5 billion for something that'll turn out to be fraudulent. That's
what?
Election money, basically.
What?
They want $3.5 trillion.
Billion, not trillion. He doesn't even know his T's from
votes.
His B's.
Okay, universal mail-in ballots. $3.5 trillion.
Billion, not trillion.
$25 billion. Billion. For the post office. Now, they need that money in order to have the post office work so it can take all of these millions and millions of ballots. Now, in the meantime, they aren't getting there. By the way, those are just two items. But if they don't get those two items, that means you can't have universal mail-in voting because they're not supposed to have it.
See, I'm trying a new strategy. You know, doing the Bill Maher laugh track thing. Because if you just laugh at what he says, maybe it's not so disturbing. But frankly, that was pretty disturbing. By the way, a Monmouth poll released Tuesday found 72% of Democrats are very or somewhat likely to vote by mail compared to 22% of Republicans. And why do you think that is? Because Donald Trump has spent the last month telling you that voting by mail is somehow weird and not doesn't work, even though he votes by mail, even though his press secretary votes by mail, even though at least, I believe, six states vote by mail. There's nothing wrong with voting by mail, unless you can't trust the Postal Service. And right now, Donald Trump has installed one of his sycophants in there, a guy who was one of Trump's major donors and owns a lot of stock in, I believe, UPS, and I also believe FedEx. I could be wrong. Maybe it's just one of them. But the point is, DeJoy is his name. Killjoy is more like it, owns stocks in companies who compete with the United States Postal Service. So, but that wasn't all Trump did today. You know, aside from saying the quiet part out loud, yeah, I'm going to stop funding for the U.S. Postal Service so those Democrats can't vote by mail. That's what that's all about. And we need to get more into that in the coming days and weeks of the show, because this is a problem. Now, David, my husband, did drop off our primary ballots. I live in Florida. Primary election day here in Florida is that we already had the presidential primary because it's Florida. They do things, you know, back asswards. But the congressional primary and other races like the supervisor of elections and the sheriff and things like that, that election is this coming Tuesday. It's the 18th of August. And so I've voted by mail for the last 10 years here in Florida. It's absentee voting. You fill out the ballot. You can throw it in the mailbox. We've always dropped it off at the supervisor of elections office just to be safe, because I want to make sure my vote counts. And frankly, right now, with the leadership at the Postal Service, I don't trust them. Do I trust the U.S. Post Office? Without a doubt. But right now, under the DeJoy tenure, no. Hell to the fuck no. Now, what David told me, usually he would bring the ballots into the actual office and they'd give you a I voted sticker. Now they have a drop box set up outside. And that's what we need in every city and every town. We need drop boxes so you can drop those ballots. It's something we need to work on. And again, I'm going to try to figure out who to get on the show to talk to about this, because we are at DEFCON, whatever the highest level is. I don't know if it's 3 or 1 or 100 or what, but you know, we're at the nuclear warning place. But that wasn't the only ridiculous thing Trump said today, because, you know, he's Donald Trump. So while he was talking to Maria Boobs Bartiromo, he also decided to take on AOC. Really? Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez? He said this.
He is going to give not tax increases, massive tax increases.
Talking about Biden,
to pay for,
of course.
AOC's plan. AOC was a poor student.
Really?
I won't say where she went to school. It doesn't matter.
Because you don't know.
This is not even a smart person.
Really?
Other than she's got a good line of stuff. I mean,
a good line of stuff?
She yaps.
What? These guys, she yaps?
They're all afraid of her. Because if you notice, all of these progressives are beating the regular Democrats.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, that was funny. Actually, what's really funnier is that AOC took that clip that somebody excerpted and tweeted out and retweeted it and wrote, "Let's make a deal, Mr. President. You release your college transcript, I'll release mine, and we'll see who is the better student. Loser has to fund the post office." Yeah, I like that. By the way, speaking of AOC, I told you yesterday when we went through the rundown, the who was going to be speaking at the virtual Democratic National Convention that begins on Monday, and I was happy to be able to say AOC got a speaking slot. Well, today we find out she gets 60 seconds. 60 seconds. I'm not kidding. 1 minute. She gets 1 minute to speak. So she's going to have to, she's going to record her segment ahead of time and just submit a videotape, really. And you know who else is going to be speaking? Who was added to the lineup? Michael Bloomberg. I Ellie Mistal has a new piece up at thenation.com, and it's about, it's titled something about the centrist blandness or something of the DNC. It's really a shame that they're doing this. Bill Clinton speaking? Why? John Kasich speaking? Double why? I just don't get it. But AOC, I gotta love her. So when she found out that she only had a minute, AOC acknowledged it, and she tweeted out a poem by Dr. Benjamin E. Mays titled, "I Have Only Just a Minute." And I wish I had pulled it. I wonder if I can pull it up real fast, because I remember this poem. "I Have Only Just a Minute," because the late Congressman Elijah Cummings actually recited it during his first floor speech to Congress in 1996. And he, and, you know, we lost Elijah Cummings last year, And so this poem was replayed as, you know, many eulogies were going around for Elijah Cummings, who was a great man. But this is what AOC tweeted out. I have only just a minute, only 60 seconds in it. Forced upon me, can't refuse it. Didn't seek it, didn't choose it. But it's up to me to use it. I must suffer if I lose it. Give account if I abuse it. Just a tiny little minute, but eternity is in it. Touche, AOC. Touche. I think that's awesome. By the way, let me just share this with you, and then we'll take a little break. Larry Kudlow, who is the moron's chief economic advisor. It's just the rabbit hole that we've gone down is so extreme. Anyway, he was talking on some show today about the fact that, you know, Congress is gone. We have no deal on a new coronavirus relief package. It's done. And Congress, the House left a few days ago. They're out until September 14th. And the Senate left today. And they're out until September 7th. Of course, if something should happen, I guess they can all be called back. But for now, they're on August recess. And when Kudlow, Larry Kudlow, was asked, you know, what's the holdup? Why couldn't you get a deal done? Listen to what he said. There was no deal because of the liberals' wish list. And you know those things that were on it, like voting rights.
So much of the Democratic asks are really liberal left wish lists. We don't want to have voting rights and aid to aliens and so forth. That's not our game.
That's not our game. Liberal, wish list, voting rights. How dare they? How dare they want their voting rights? Those damn Democrats. Who would have thought? Just unbelievable. Oh, let me play one more Trump clip and then I'm done, because this was the best of them all. This one actually was from yesterday, I guess, during one of his, I can't call them, you know, coronavirus task force briefing sessions, because there is no task force. He thinks you'd rather hear from his addled brain than actual experts, you know, professionals, doctors, people who know what the hell they're doing. This was quintessential Trump, because, you know, he's talking about eliminating the payroll taxes. First of all, as I've explained before, it does nothing for the millions of people who find themselves now unemployed, therefore not on any payroll. So there are no taxes to be withheld or exempted from. So there's that. The other part is payroll taxes. What he's talking about is what the employee pays into Medicare and Social Security. He's talking about starving the Social Security Trust Fund. And he's talking about making these cuts permanent if he's reelected. So that means he is starving Social Security and Medicare. So one of the intrepid reporters in the White House briefing room yesterday asked him about it. And his answer is just truly hysterical.
If you permanently rescind the payroll tax, how do you pay for Social Security?
We're taking it out of the general fund.
And what we'll do, general fund?
Yeah, what we'll be doing is, if we do that, we'll get it approved, in that case, by Congress, and we'll take the money from other places other than, we will not take it from Social Security.
Bullshit.
In any way, shape, or form.
How do you fund it from the general fund when the general fund just incurred a debt of $2.8 trillion?
Right, but we're going to have tremendous growth. We have tremendous growth. You take a look at what's happening here. Next year, unless somebody comes in who doesn't know what they're doing and they start raising taxes and forcing everybody to leave the country or leave their jobs and companies to close, we will have tremendous growth. You will see growth like you haven't seen in a long time.
Okay, how they didn't laugh in his face, I don't know. Therefore, there's your laugh track. What insanity. We're going to have tremendous growth, Donald Trump. I got a little song for you. All right. Let's take a quick time out so our friends at the Progressive Voices Network can get some business taken care of. We'll be right back. It's Nicole Sandler at NicoleSandler.com. and the Progressive Voices Network. They are in commercials now. All right, so let me think. What else did I want to go through with you? I'm really freaking out about this Postal Service thing, because this is Donald Trump in desperate mode. This is desperation time. So he is trying to dismantle the U.S. Postal Service, right? There's an ad campaign out there. This one, and I'll play you a spot. This one is tailored for Ohio and Senator Hawley, but they customize them for every state. So fill in the blank with your own senator. Here's an ad that says, keep the U.S. Postal Service delivering.
Across America, folks are learning to do more with less, including the U.S. Postal Service. Frontline postal workers delivered our essentials and medicine despite emergency cost and less revenue. But now, the Postal Service could be forced to raise prices and cut services, hurting consumers and small businesses. Call Senator Hawley now. Urge him to co-sponsor the Postal Service Emergency Assistance Act. The conservative approach. Reliable. Delivering. Every door. Every day. Across America, folks are learning to do more with less.
I do that. Sometimes I don't finish it up fast enough. But anyway, so an effective spot, but we need more oomph than that. I don't know what the answer is, but we need to all get on it. Call your senators and congressperson, but guess what? They're all on their August recess. And it's not like they're doing town halls because, we can't get out and see people, but maybe they're doing virtual town halls. Maybe they're doing Zoom town halls. You can still call their offices, though they're on recess. They're supposed to be in their home offices. So maybe, just maybe, it'll be easier to get a hold of your representative, and they need to do something about this. Because you know what Donald Trump is focused on? This will be our last story, and we'll get Howie Klein on the line. This one, again, I just couldn't make this shit up if I tried. The Energy Department has proposed rolling back the 3-decade-old efficiency standards for shower heads because of Donald Trump's repeated gripes about subpar water pressure while he's washing his hair. You know, that thing, the dead thing that sits on top of his head, he calls it his hair. I guess that's a curious name for it, but whatever. I guess when he tries to wash that creature, the water pressure isn't strong enough for him. So this plan would change the federal definition of a shower head to allow manufacturers to drastically increase water use under rules that Congress passed in 1992 in response to severe droughts. Water flow from an entire shower head was limited to 2.5 gallons per minute. This proposed change would allow manufacturers to apply that restriction to each nozzle on the shower head. So I don't know about you, but I have one of those rain sort of, there are a lot of little nozzles on them. 2.5 gallons per minute could come out of each one of those nozzles. This man is certifiable. I guess I should, once again, let the laughers take over. It's hysterical, right? I just don't know how to move forward from that. All right, let's bring our friends from the Progressive Voices Network back.
And now, back to Nicole on Progressive Voices and NicoleSandler.com.
And my husband, acting as my producer, thankfully filled me in that Hawley is from Missouri, not Ohio. Who did I confuse him with in Ohio? Missouri, he's the guy who beat Claire McCaskill, I think. Yeah. All right. So let's not wait any longer. You know what we do at this time each week. Oh, I got to find my Howie Klein open, my Chucky Schmucky open. I'm so unprepared today. All right. Let's do it, shall we?
Are you a multinational corporation hungry for a treat? Well, come on down to Schmucky Chucky's, where you'll personally be seated by Chuck Schumer himself.
So many dishes, and they're all fresh.
You're gonna love our Blue Dog special, the Dino Burger, because we say so.
A good hamburger and french fries.
And every burger comes with a side order of...
grits. I love grits. I love anything with corn. It's corn.
All for only $50,000. Wash it all down with a Dirty Debbie.
9/10 water, 1/10 oranges. After a week or two, you drink this, it's 200 calories and it's acetic.
And wipe your mouth with a tissue print of Glass-Steagall. For dessert, try our DNC tarts.
Little cookies, tell the quality of that.
Most restaurants give you a mint, but at Schmucky Chucky's, you get complimentary.
Sweet and low.
Hold on, Howie.
Picks up the tab for all this? Find out now with Howie Klein of DownWithTyranny.com on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Ah, hello, Howie Klein. Sorry about that. I realized I was playing the intro on the same pot that you come up on, and therefore you couldn't hear it.
Oh, one of the pleasures of my week is hearing.
Oh, well, we got the batch of Dirty Debbies all mixed up, and little Chucky Schmucky is, you know, out there saying, "You go, girl," or something like that.
I actually have a tape of it and listen to it every now and then.
Good. Well, I'm glad you enjoy that, and I'm sure Boca Brittany Summers is as well, because she produced that. And yeah. So, Howie, I'm kind of up in arms at the moment. I'm really upset about this whole Postal Service thing. Does that freak you out as it does me?
Yes, it does. It freaks me out. It freaks a lot of people out. And, you know, I've been talking to a lot of members of Congress about it who are fuming. You know, the people I talk to obviously are fuming. And then I keep wondering, what the hell are they going to do about it?
Yeah.
And I'm writing a post. It's almost finished for tomorrow about that. And, you know, Ted Lieu just said to me, you know, I want to be a realist about this. There's nothing we can do.
Oh, my God.
Trump will veto anything. The Senate's not going to override that veto. And that's, it's up to the voters now.
Wow. We've got...
So there really isn't any, you know, some of them are still talking about, you know, having hearings and, you know, yelling at people and all this kind of stuff. And yes, I mean, do it. Some of the Democratic candidates are using it as a campaign issue. Kara Eastman today had a really, really strong slam against her opponent, who's a Trump ass kisser. What's his name? Donald J. Bacon.
Really?
Just based on his backing of Trump on the post office. So you know, yes, it's something that is it's a big deal. It's a horrific thing, and you know what can I say? I hope it contributes to the biggest landslide in the history of the United States against Trump and Pence.
I hope so too, but it's going to take even more effort. Look, we need a big landslide. We need it to be so overwhelmingly obvious that we want him out of there, that he can't fight it, that he can't claim it was all fixed. We remember he said it was going to be all fixed before when he thought he was going to lose in 2016. All of a sudden he won and then it's not fixed anymore. What's that?
He was telling the truth. He did fix it.
Exactly. And so, you know, now they're talking about setting up drop boxes in every county, which, you know, whatever it takes. I was just saying before I brought you on that we always vote absentee, but we also always hand deliver our ballots to the supervisor of elections office. And David brought our ballots in today, and he said they actually put a drop box outside. So rather than having to walk in the office and hand it to them, you just put it in the drop box and it's effectively delivered. But I don't know that cities and counties are going to be able to get that together.
Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, part of the problem is, you know, people have these expectations, and they're fair expectations, but, you know, under Trump, we've got to go in a different direction, but people have these expectations that everything should, you know, come easy.
Right.
And, you know, they can vote.
They can vote.
You know, put up on your damn mask and your gloves and go vote.
That's right.
Or go to a drop box. Or, you know, there are a lot of ways to do it. Is it important enough to do it?
Yes.
Well, it is. It is, I think, to a lot of people. but I guess not to everybody.
Wow. I don't know. We'll see how important it is, I guess, come November 3rd. I don't know. So, Howie Klein, we had another primary day on Tuesday.
Wait, before we move on, okay. Let me just say one thing.
Yes.
Since I might have sounded like I was not clear on something.
Okay.
Do I think that Trump should get the death penalty eventually after being tried? Absolutely.
Okay.
The crimes against democracy are very, very serious. If we don't punish them seriously, then they will. That's just an encouragement to do them over again. Trump in prison for 10 years is a bunch of bullshit. That should
yep.
not be what happens. Trump executed on television? Yes.
Well, you know what?
Only after a trial.
After a trial, and he's found guilty of treason, because I think what he's doing, I believe his sabotage of the U.S. Postal Service as a way to keep people from voting, from exercising their constitutional right to vote, is treason. Am I wrong?
That's, you know, how much treason has this guy done? How many times can we, you know, what, I mean, every day it's another outrage
yep.
against America, another outrage against everything our country stands for and has always stood for. This guy is the worst of the worst of the worst. Anyone who wants to argue that he is, that this, you know, that Nixon was worse or Reagan was worse or,
nope.
you know, they've got their heads up their asses.
Yeah.
I mean, those people were terrible, yeah. But nothing compared to Trump. Trump is the most existential threat to this country since the Civil War, unquestionably.
I agree. So okay, then let me ask. But so you're in California, you're still not going to vote for Biden.
Right.
But only because you're in California.
If you said that, I might have said, and if I lived in Florida, I wouldn't either.
Oh.
I wouldn't say that now.
Okay.
And now I don't know. Or I might.
Okay, but you don't have to. It's a non-issue. So it's a moot point, as they say. So I hear you. All right.
California's electoral votes are going to Biden.
Sure.
No matter how I vote.
Right.
So it doesn't really make a difference.
I understand. But I'm in Florida, and I don't have that luxury. And I will. I've still got
my... I urge you to do what you need to do.
I will. And I've still, you know, I've still got my my industrial strength nose clips. I keep them handy. They're right here. So when I fill out the ballot, I can put it on. And... yeah, and I will cast my vote. But it is a vote against Donald Trump and everything he stands for. So we had, now can I move on? We had good news on Tuesday in that the fourth member of the squad, those progressive first-term members of the House, who have all won their primaries, despite the fact that the media and the Democratic Party establishment, it seemed, we're all cheering on their challengers. This time it was Ilhan Omar in Minnesota who was going to be routed by her primary opponent. And she beat her handily, right?
Yes. She beat her primary opponent, but people don't realize who her primary opponent was. They think it's this guy who no one ever heard of, who is meaningless. It's just some random person who popped up out of nowhere.
Right.
Her primary opponent was APAC.
Oh,
I mean, APAC has a history of going after African-American members of Congress who dare to insist on equality for Palestinians. They will not accept that, and they label them anti-Semites, and then they pour whatever money it takes to defeat them. They did it against Earl Hilliard in Alabama
mm-hmm.
successfully, and they did it successfully against Cynthia McKinney in Georgia.
Right.
They just, and then they wanted to do it against Rashida, but they couldn't because the woman that was running against Rashida is also not a pro-Israeli enough
uh-huh.
for them. So they left Rashida alone this time, thank goodness. But they spent millions and millions of dollars. So not just helping the random person who ran against Ilhan to raise money, which they did. But on top of that, they put together a super PAC where both Israel, you know, a lot of that money came from Israel,
yeah.
from rich APAC supporters, both Democrats and Republicans. And they did a smear campaign, a huge multi-million dollar smear campaign against Ilhan. And she beat all of that. and she beat it handily.
Mm-hmm.
So people say she managed to hang on. No, she slaughtered her opponent.
Wow. Yeah, that's awesome. That's, I mean, good. And it shows that, you know what, the progressives are in good shape, that they're we're pretty strong right now, I think. I hope that's
certainly
what it
in
means.
Minneapolis.
Certainly in Minneapolis, right. So we got the squad is in good standing heading into the general, and they're all in good shape. There was another, I'm sorry?
About to expand their ranks.
Yes, well, exactly, because we've got a few good progressives in the general, and we'll move into that in the coming weeks. There was another, Georgia had their primary on Tuesday as well, and Donald Trump applauded the winner of the race in Georgia's, oh, I don't have it here, I think it's the 11th, no, I don't know what district, 14th maybe? 14th, Marjorie Taylor Greene. She beat out the establishment Republican candidate in the primary, but she's the one Trump wanted, and she's a QAnon nut. Yes?
Oh, yeah. She's a nut in general. She's also anti-Semitic, and she's a racist. You know, it's funny. I've known Ilhan. Sorry to go back to this.
That's okay.
You'll see why.
Okay.
I've known Ilhan for many, many years. She was part of People for the American Way's young elected officials when she was in the state legislature. I have followed her career before most people outside of Minnesota ever heard her name.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on the board of People for the American Way. There are a lot of Jewish people on the board of People for the
of
American
course.
Way.
Of course. Hey, Norman Lear, you know, he founded it, and he's Jewish, right?
Yes.
Yes.
And no one ever even, it never crossed anyone's mind that this woman is anti-Semitic. She's mm-hmm. not anti-Semitic. It's no. a lie. And it's a lie that they use because they want to say because she doesn't kiss ass to the Likud party of mm-hmm. Israel, the far-right party, that therefore she must be anti-Semitic. Well, she's not anti-Semitic in any way, shape, or form. And I've known her for over a decade. I can tell you that over a decade before she was elected to Congress. And here we have, on the other hand, in Georgia, this Trump candidate who is, you know, saying horrible anti-Semitic things publicly, and because she means it, because she is an anti-Semite. Where's AIPAC there? What are they doing about it? They don't say a word? Are they putting millions of dollars in against her? No, of course not. She's going to be elected to Congress, this woman. This district is, when you read about the worst places where reopening is a complete catastrophe,
right.
And there are hundreds and hundreds of kids coming down with COVID, and
yep.
people throughout all these counties are getting going into quarantine. When you read about this, is the district.
This is the district. This is the high school.
They don't identify it that way. They identify it by county. All those counties are in this district. I'm sorry.
You can. That's fine.
District, Northwest Georgia.
Uh huh.
Many of it, part of the metro, Atlanta metro, by the way.
Hmm.
Where these people actually go to work in Atlanta. This is a district that where Hillary got 22% of the vote. This is how red and repulsive and backward this district is. A bunch of, you know, I don't want to start disparaging everybody. I could get right into it, and I don't want to.
I hear you.
But she is them. They are her. This is their candidate. They love her.
Yeah. Well, this is her.
The Republican establishment was against her.
Yep.
They didn't care.
No, they're happy. They're fine. And Trump.
Them. She is what they are. They are this.
Right.
We should build a wall around this district. We should give this district to Russia. Let them have it.
I want to play for you.
There's no chance of her not winning, by the way.
There's no chance of her not winning. That's really frightening. But yeah, you're right. There's no chance of her not winning. I hear you. Exactly what we've been told she is. She's everything that the media makes her out to. I want to play a clip, and I'm afraid, hold on, if I play it here, you're not going to hear it. But I don't have it pulled up on the other computer. So let me just share this. This is Marjorie Taylor Greene. At her victory event on Tuesday night.
On the Quran and be sworn in? No.
Oh, this wasn't
You have
that.
To be sworn in on the Bible. But we have an Islamic invasion into our government offices.
Yeah, that was a different clip. That was her talking about you can't be sworn into Congress on a Quran, only on a Bible, because we have an Islamic invasion into our congressional offices. That's who this woman is. And the other clip I was going to play was her at her victory party celebration Tuesday night, where he's like, we're going to kick that bitch Pelosi out of Congress. You know, they gave Rashida Tlaib for shit for saying something similar, but it's okay if you're a Republican.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, people are giving her shit too, but it's absolutely outrageous. And the Republican Party knows it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they're embarrassed of her. She says what they're supposed to keep quiet. You know, they yep. probably half of them believe the same stuff. They just don't talk about it.
Of course, because they know more than to say it.
On the other hand, Kevin McCarthy announced this morning, yes, she will be getting committee assignments. As a Republican.
Oh, my God. This is just frightening.
And there's another lunatic just like her in Colorado. I can't remember her name. She also got the Republican nomination in a pretty red district. Her district is red, but not as red.
Uh-huh.
I mean, you know, her district is a red district, but a Democrat has a chance to win it. And I think the Democrat in that district probably is going to.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in this Georgia district, there's nothing. I mean, every single person I'm not going to do it. This district is so red. I think it was like it's like R plus 27.
Ooh.
If I remember.
Ooh. Wow. You know what? I'm torn because you mentioned People for the American Way, and you have a post up at Down with Tyranny about them, and there's a new spot that I want to play, but I also want to talk about another very red district. So let's do this real quick, and then we'll go to People Four. Your favorite hot gay Republican congressman wannabe, who is running for Mark Meadows' seat in North Carolina's 11th, his name is Madison Cawthorn.
He's not gay.
He's not gay? He looks like...
He looks gay. He's not gay.
Oh, no, I thought he was gay.
He's not gay. No, no.
Oh. He's
gays
just...
Gays love him. I mean, gays who don't understand politics and don't understand what he would like to do to them...
Right.
...love him because, he's very built and defined.
Oh,
and,
I thought he was gay.
If you like him... No, no, I don't think so. All the gay media writes about him just because they want to use his pictures.
Gotcha.
But he's the perfect Aryan youth. In fact, he said on his bucket list was the Hitler's Berchtesgaden Eagle's Nest, which he went to with his brother and, and took pictures and talked about it. I mean, I lived there. I lived right near Berchtesgaden for a while when I was in Europe.
Okay.
I never even thought about going up to that thing. I was not interested. And I could have done it at any time I wanted. But this guy said it was on his bucket list.
Ooh.
I mean, I have a bucket list. That's not part of it.
No, mine neither. But this district is very curious because it's an extremely gerrymandered district in North Carolina that is also one of the reddest, I guess, in the country, the reddest in North Carolina. And
the reddest in North Carolina, yes, but it's an R plus 14.
Okay.
So think about that compared to the district we just talked about in Georgia. R plus 27.
Wow.
An R plus 14 would be really, really hard for a Democrat to win, but not out of the question. The guy who's running against him is if I remember correctly.
Mo Davis. Do you know him?
Yes. Marine Colonel.
He's wonderful. I've actually interviewed him because he used to be the commander at Guantanamo Bay, and he's one of us, as far as I can tell. I mean, I don't know him well, but he's been on the show a couple of times, and he's great.
Oh, could you introduce me to him?
Yes.
Could you send me an email and him an email?
Absolutely. Absolutely will. I will, because I was thinking I need to get him back on the show. I didn't even realize he was running until yesterday. So I'm thrilled that it's him. And the thing that's so weird about this district is it's gerrymandered to cut around Asheville, North Carolina, which is the most progressive part of North Carolina. And if they hadn't gerrymandered Asheville out of that district, maybe it would be more gettable, wouldn't it?
Yes, there was before they gerrymandered Asheville out of the district, a Democrat won it.
Wow.
He, not a good Democrat, but it was Heath Shuler, and he held the seat a couple of cycles before he retired. But yeah, if Asheville were in the district, it would, this nut wouldn't win it.
Okay. Well, you've got a great post up about Madison Cawthorn. I mean, even his name is just, he doesn't look real.
Didn't say things like that. I know what you mean.
I know, everyone right? Else. All right. So let's go back to People for the American Way, because at downwithtyranny.com, you've got a post up about them and this new campaign that they've launched. And you are a board member of People for the American Way, which was founded by Norman Lear, the great, amazing Norman Lear, who's still active. But the day-to-day operations have been taken over by Ben Jealous?
Yes. Ben Jealous was just elected president this past month.
Right. And that's a good thing. I still have one of my favorite campaign buttons of all time that I've held on to is from the 2012 presidential election. And it's like a line drawing of the Supreme Court. And it says, you know, People for the American Way across the top. And it says, Obama 2012. It's the Supreme Court, stupid. And you know what? We didn't drive that message. The Democrats didn't drive that message home in 2016. The Republicans did. And they took advantage of it. So what's People for the American Way, what's this campaign about?
So they got together, well, right now it doesn't, but it's probably going to increase, of top American artists, painters and other artists, but mostly painters. Mm-hmm. And they're going to put up billboards all over the swing states. Of artwork, like, you know, there's the one on my blog is, I think, in Milwaukee, and it takes up the whole side of an apartment building.
Wow.
And the artwork is beautiful and challenging, and will make people think about the election. And it's called Enough is Enough, and it's a great program, and, you know, people can buy prints of it if they want, or support it in many other ways, and they're encouraging people to do art as well as part of this thing. So there are a lot of moving parts, and I tried to talk about it a little bit on my blog last night, mm-hmm. and links to the various places where you can go to do various things, whether it's to buy a piece or to create a piece.
Well, let's show the spot, because it gives more practical examples of what they're talking about. So here it is.
Love
it. From People. Inspiring. People for the American Way.
We need your help. For nearly 40 years, People for the American Way has been working to advance progressive policies and fight right-wing extremism. But the truth is, in all that time, we've never seen anyone as destructive and dangerous as Donald Trump.
And this is their new hoax.
The United States coronavirus case count hit 4 million this past week.
More than 52 million people filing for the first time for unemployment benefits.
Yeah, no, I don't take responsibility at all.
Together, we can defeat Donald Trump in November. That is why we've launched the Enough of Trump campaign, a multi-platform movement to flood key swing states with public art projects in advance of the 2020 presidential election. We've brought together over a dozen of the greatest American artists of our time, and with your help, we'll be putting Enough of Trump artwork on strategically placed billboards in Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan. Trump won those three states by less than 100,000 votes in total back in 2016. We can't let this happen again. We believe in the cultural power of artists and their ability to envision the world we want to live in. Artists are always at the forefront of movements, connecting to the hearts and minds of the people. And this campaign is no different. We need them to lead us into a better, brighter future. This is just the start of our movement. With your help, we can end this national nightmare.
For the American Way, Howie Klein, that really, it's a great ad, and it's a great campaign, and I love that they're embracing the arts.
Yep, very, very, very inspiring, and, you know, people should check it out, and, you know, people who couldn't see the video that you just played, mm-hmm. you need to go need to go and look at it. It's just really, really fantastically done. And the artwork itself is absolutely beautiful.
Like,
really, really beautiful.
Yeah, I'll post.
About, you know, real artists like Ed Ruscha, for example, was one of the ones.
Right, Shepard Fairey did a special poster for this. I will post the video. I'll embed it on my blog where I post the day's show, which I've also been posting the video too, because for the people, because we're still, you know, I'm suspended from YouTube. I can't stream on YouTube right now. Because of a Don Henley song, of all things. I played 20 seconds of a Don Henley song at the end of a show, at the end of a newscast that played after the show back in 2017, and they just flagged me on it and suspended me from live streaming. Fucking Don Henley. Sorry, just had a vent.
Who did that?
Universal Music Publishing Group, apparently.
Did you talk to them?
Oh, I've been trying. You have no idea. This has been about 3 or 4 weeks now already, so I've been going back and forth. So we are streaming on Facebook Live, on Periscope, on Twitch, and I think Instagram, if Paul got us up on Instagram today. But I'm suspended from streaming on YouTube, so I've been
How
in bed.
I used to make YouTube videos. I used to do it a lot, and I enjoyed it. They're very time-consuming, but I used to really, it was a joy for me. It was just something that took up a lot of time, and I loved. And I use music that I personally own.
Right.
So, in other words, where I am the publisher, I use the music that I own.
Yep.
And they suspended me from YouTube, and there was no one I could talk to about it.
It's amazing.
Months. And then finally, I just gave up and said, well, bye-bye YouTube. And never made another video again.
Wow. Well, you know, and I've had artists, I've been doing this Monday music thing on and off, and I've had artists come on playing their own songs, and the same thing happens. We get flagged. Dan Navarro is a good friend of mine. He's been doing a nightly coronavirus concert every day since the quarantine began, and he gets flagged regularly for playing his own songs.
And then you know, it's not like you can call them up and explain it to them. There's no one to call up.
Exactly. So I've been going back and forth with some unnamed bot from Google or YouTube, and nameless, faceless people at Universal Music Publishing Group. But from my days in L.A., I've got a number of friends who are all trying to work back channels for me, trying to do everything possible. But so far, no luck. It's ridiculous.
Awful.
Yes. Anyway, we got off on a tangent there. So, Howie Klein, I'd be remiss if we didn't take at least a minute and ask you to weigh in on Kamala Harris as Joe Biden's VP pick.
Why? Look, there were worse people who he was thinking about.
That's true.
So she's better than Susan Rice.
Yep.
You know, he wasn't going to ever pick Elizabeth Warren. That wasn't real.
No.
She would have, of all the people that they talked about, she was the only one that I really, really liked.
Yeah, me too.
Karen Bass. And he was sick either. She was pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
So Kamala, you know, it could have been worse. I never voted for Kamala Harris when she ran for Attorney General in my state. I never voted for her when she ran for Senate. She's not someone, you know, she didn't just appear to me when she decided to run for president. I know who this woman is, and I know that it's not someone that I would like to see in public office.
Yep.
She's no good.
Yeah, nope.
Is she better than Joe Biden? Oh, yes, a lot better than Joe Biden. There's no comparison. She at least identifies as a progressive. She has, you know, Ed Markey, according to Progressive Punch,
mm-hmm.
Ed Markey has the single most progressive voting record of anyone in the U.S. Senate,
okay.
More than Bernie.
Wow.
But number two is a tie between a lot of people, and Kamala Harris is one of them.
Right.
She has a very, very, very progressive voting record.
Gotcha.
Is she a very, very, very progressive politician?
No.
Nope. But she has a great voting record. On the other hand, Joe Biden would be at the very, very
of
bottom
course.
If he was still a senator.
Of course.
You know, he identified as being a very, very conservative Democrat. She identifies as being a very progressive Democrat.
Right.
So, yeah, she's better than him.
Gotcha. I'll tell you, you know, I learned something very valuable, because right after the news broke, I tweeted out, "Let me start the campaign today at Rep. Katie Porter to fill Kamala Harris's Senate seat." It is my most retweeted and liked tweet ever. I got so far over 7,000 retweets, 33,000 likes, And I mean, it's just gone nuts. It hasn't slowed down since I posted it. Katie Porter has got a lot of fans out there.
Yes, she does. But there, she's not in contention.
No.
Gavin Newsom gets to pick who will be the next senator.
Yeah.
He's not Katie Porter. He's likely to pick a Hispanic.
Oh.
That's the largest single voting group in California. They've never had a... There's never been a Hispanic senator, as far as I know. And, the money, the smart money right now is on the Attorney General.
Becerra.
Javier
Becerra. All right. Well, that's okay. Gotcha.
But
yep.
I'm kind of, hoping that
Ted Lieu.
Hilda Solis gets it.
Uh-huh. Okay. That would work, too.
Sure, and so Alex Padillo is another possibility. Or maybe he'll go for another minority. I mean, my dream candidate for this job would be Ted Lieu.
Ted Lieu. I hear you. I'm there as well. All right. Well, with that, Howie Klein, we'll see where it goes. Thank you, as always. We'll talk to you next week.
Bye-bye.
And I'll see you tomorrow. Norman Solomon's going to be here tomorrow to talk about this campaign to vote Trump out. I'll see you tomorrow. Thanks, everyone. Bye.